Question number one, if I use a Leica lens, will I get Leica colors? No, not at all. The Leica colors are a result of Leica firmware. It's a color profile. You see, when you have the profiles here, different profiles, and you get a different look. And I think Thornstern Overguard is actually selling Leica presets, where you plug in your image and the color palette changes into a more Leica look. If you stack a Nikon lens on your Leica camera, you will still get the Leica colors. The lens is transparent glass, it's not going to affect the image much. Now, some lenses will affect the image, and veering off the realistic is what you don't want in the RAW file. You want to do that in the JPEG preferably, you know, in the final product after editing. At least that's my approach about it. Now, there is another issue too. The issue that your sensor is capturing Profoto RGB, which is a very wide color space, captures all these colors, and that's what your RAW file contains. But your monitor is only sRGB, and the images you upload on the internet are by default sRGB or are converted into sRGB. Okay, this is where we work with on the internet and everything. So try to find differences in tonalities and stuff. I mean, between lenses, the only thing that I'm interested in is whether the lens has a problem or not. As I said before and many times, the chromatic aberrations, distortion, this and that. I'm not interested in whether a lens can capture a little more red here, because I'm never going to see it probably in my lifetime, where we're going to have Profoto monitors. But let me show you an example. This image is a Fuji RAW file. And if I go here, view, you see proof setup, custom, and I set it to simulate sRGB, which is the color space we all work in. And then I go in and I say gamut warning. It's going to show me all the colors that the sRGB is not going to show. You see all these areas that popped out? All these areas are marked by the software as areas where the color, the full spectrum of the color is not visible on my monitor. It's not gonna be visible on the internet, it's not gonna be visible anywhere where sRGB is used. If I turn it off, I have this. Now I think that this is, oh, this is so wonderful, the different tonalities of red, while in reality I'm not even displaying one third of the tonalities that the sensor captured. The two subsequent questions that arise are, A, why did you get a specific lens? Write it down in two lines, one sentence, or two sentences, in two lines. Why did you get the specific lens? What are you going to use it for? And second, if you say something like, oh, it's got better micro contrast, the question is, can you prove the claim to yourself? Like, take a few images with the lens that you say has better micro contrast, and take the same images also with an average modern lens of the same focal length and compare them and try to find the micro contrast that you say is better. Prove it to yourself, not to me. Question number two, what is the dimensional effect?
How it begins to how it ends. The dolly zoom shot can start like a telephoto lens, where the camera is far away and the focal length is bigger. There's less background in sight because the lens concentrates on a smaller portion of it. But when you change focal length by zooming out while also pushing the camera forward, you can observe more of the background while keeping the foreground in the same place. The result?
Well, that's one way to do it, to create a strong dimensional effect, right? Basically, one way is to push the background further away, and there are some lenses that tend to give the visual impression that the background is pushed towards the photographer, and that kind of makes the area look shorter in a way. And we say sometimes that this is an unrealistic drawing of the scene, and it's a little bit on the flat side. Then you have other lenses that do not really draw well around objects, including faces, and this and that. But the differences are so subtle, so little, that you have to pretty much see the entire image. Now, in this image, for example, here, what do we have? We have, let's say, the background is pushed further away. The background has no micro contrast here, no good micro contrast anyway, right? The whole scene doesn't have good micro contrast, right? However, you need the micro contrast where the different tonalities are going to show, I mean, give the impression of the ridges on his forehead, next to his nose and all that. It's the whole drawing of the three-dimensional objects, right? That's where you need more resolution and more tonalities to display these ridges very realistically, right? That's where the micro contrast comes in, the details. But in the overall image, what matters is the relationship between the background and the foreground and the items that are placed in there. So let me give you some, let's say, extreme examples of it. This is a kind of an extreme example of a flattening scene. You cannot see forward and backward. Everything seems to be in the same plane. You cannot really distinguish the distances. For example, this house over here on the lower left side, if you just look at the image and you're not familiar with the area, you will assume that this house is right behind this tree. Let me give you the reality of it. This house is about 35 to 40 meters behind this tree. And it looks as, almost as it is embedded in the tree. That's an example of a flattening perspective. Another example of a flattening perspective is this image with the 24 to 85 by Ken Rockwell, where I can really not make heads or tails of how far the background is, this part here. It seems as if I cannot really visualize the course of the beam, of this wooden beam as it goes down. I cannot tell the distances, I cannot visualize the place. It all seems so flattened. And this is a lens actually that renders a little bit on the flat side if you're not careful about the angle of the shot. On the other hand, every time I see images of the Nikon 24-120, which is in the same zoom category, I see that the dimensional rendering is nice. It's nice, it's pleasant to the eye, it's more pleasant to the eye. This lens has less micro contrast than the 24-85. It's less sharp. Okay, and it's less contrasty overall. But it renders nicer, I don't know. This is a similar image with the beam that we saw in the bar, right? And here you can visualize the whole scene and the distance from here to here, from where you stand all the way to here, how the entire scene is drawn. You can picture yourself in there. Remember the image with the branches, the tree branches, that they all look flattened? Well, this is the opposite. This is a very three-dimensional scene of tree branches. You can tell which one is in the back, which one is in the front, the distance between them, everything. This is a very dimensional rendering from a lens that should not have that much dimensionality given its focal length. Specifically, it's from the Nikon 300 F4 AFS, the old one, the heavy one. Remember this image from the test of the 105, the Nikon, how dimensional it looks, but there is also the reason that you have a very sharp item in focus, which creates also a strong contrast with the background, especially with the green areas, right? And the bokeh is towards the darker side, and this helps it a lot more for the main subject to kind of pop out of the scene. And that is contrary to some pictures I have seen from the same lens, where it doesn't really look that much dimensional. You know why? Because the photographer has chosen not scenes, not a model with a strong contrast to the background. and the background in many cases. And he actually has chosen a portrait profile, and the portrait profile is of reduced contrast. And now look at this case. This image doesn't look really dimensional, right? And the model doesn't really pop out of the scene. And this here wouldn't even look like a bridge if you were not accustomed to it. And the problem is the whole flattened contrast that he used in this scene. Probably he used a flat profile. Okay, so the model doesn't really pop out, and the bokeh area is way too strong for anything to pop out of it. It's the whole contrast of the scene. It's the JPEG profile that was used, which makes it this way, and it kind of looks flattened out. The angle also plays a big role. This is very dimensional. Micro contrast sucks in this image because it's a very low resolution image displayed on the internet, right? This is like, what, 0.2 megapixels? This is nothing. How many tonalities of gray? I don't know, 5? And that's it, because it's a low resolution, small scan that is posted on the internet, but it's very dimensional. It gives a very dimensional effect. Notice also the role of the black that I have pointed out in previous videos. On the other hand, this looks a lot flatter. This looks flat because of the angle. Although this micro contrast is better. I see it's more sharp, it's got more tonalities and everything. But it's flat. What really draws my attention to a lens is how it renders the round structures. Like the really round. And one would say, well, yeah, that's because of the many tonalities of the colors and everything. All right, let's take away the colors. Let's take away micro contrast. You see? It's still there. Some lenses have it, some lenses they render it more flat, more like it's a part of the surface, especially from afar. So some lenses have it, some lenses don't. The lenses that have it are not perfect in other ways, and sometimes some lenses don't want to have it. It depends on what you want to portray and show in the scene. Notice the face on this model. Looks like a carton prop, right? It looks like it's made out of carton, like it's completely two-dimensional. So, and it's also the angle of shooting here. Notice in this image, posted in a blog named Photography Life from the Tamron 15-30, how the surface is so flattened out. It's like there's a gigantic glass on top of the flowers, and it pushes them down all to the same level. There is nothing protruding upwards. Look at the trees that look like carton props. Go to this blog and check out the next image where you're gonna see this girl in the middle of between the skyscrapers. Not skyscrapers, these buildings. And she looks like she's made out of a carton prop. On the other hand, a similar image with the Nikon 14-24, even at 14 millimeters, you see the flowers here, they're not flattened. They pop out upwards just nicely, even at 14 millimeters, which 14-15 is quite wider, as a matter of fact. 1 millimeter in that focal range makes a difference. Although the image is a mess, it is at least a little more dimensional, right? And finally, this image, which I also consider a reference image for dimensionality. Look at how the girl here on the left, she looks as if she's hovering over the scene, right? As if she's flying off the grass. The same applies for this couple here and for the tennis player, although it's not clear whether she's jumping or not at this point. Now that's dimensional effect. That's extreme dimensional effect of the image. That's almost like a hologram or something. And this is again with a Zeiss Biogon 35 on a Sony ILCE 7M2, whatever that is. Incredible, right? Incredible. It looks like a hologram also, almost. Question number three, what is pop? When we say the image pops, the subject pops out of the image. It is the emphasis on the main subject against a weaker background. It doesn't always guarantee dimensionality. For example, this has tremendous pop, and it has good dimensionality on the main subject, right? But not exceptionally on the entire image, because that was the intention of the photographer, or that was his result. This image has pop, the main subject kind of pops, but the background is not weak enough and it looks a little flat. Surprisingly, this is all also with a Biagon 35. So as I told you, use a dimensional lens, but you can get a flatter result. It depends on the background, on the angle of the shoot, a lot of factors really. Now in this case, if the background was darker, we would have a stronger pop, correct? That's obvious. For example, this picture I took in Michigan with a Voigtlander 125 has a little stronger pop because the background is weaker. It needs a little light, actually, more on the main subject to make it even more pop out, and you can fix that in Photoshop very easily in 10 seconds. And it's probably better to use the image I just showed you before instead of this one, because in this one we have a very strong background, strong light in the background, and the pop is obviously less. Pop can be achieved with flash, rendering the background darker. She pops out of the picture, or even with sunlight, if the edges of the main subject have a strong contrast against the background. This is just a cloudy day, no flash, nothing. Or the reverse, where we have the main subject being darker than the background, but in focus, and it the edges of the main subject, which is the girl, are very strong and high contrasty and sharp against a blurry background. This is with the Otus 55. The previous one with a girl that I took, also my daughter, was with the Zeiss 85 planner. And finally, question number four, can I enhance micro contrast in Photoshop? Well, yes, to a certain extent. Let's take this image for example. And one would say, oh, such a nice micro contrast Voigtlander 58, yada yada, but not enough pixels apparently, you know. Or maybe, I don't know, the light was wrong, or I had focused somewhere else. It looks more like the focus was somewhere over here than over there, right? So how do we improve the micro contrast, which is both the sharpness and the tonality ranges and the clarity in tonalities of this image? Well, we can do a little work in Photoshop, just a little sharpening. That's all really. And let's look at the results. Before is on the left and after is on the right. That's with just a little sharpening in Photoshop. I hope you can see it on your screens. That's why I love Nikon RAW files. They have an extreme plasticity. I mean, you can sharpen the crap out of them and they do not fall apart. This is what I didn't like in the Sony A7 R2, for example. Never tested on the R3. I don't know what the new model is gonna do, but the Nikon files, even from the DA10, had this excellent plasticity that you could sharpen, you could do this, you could do that without the pixels falling apart. And you can see the before and after. And the after doesn't look like a crappy or anything, like crappy sharpening. Looks very realistic. And I didn't do any alchemist. I don't even know the software that well. Now there are some traces of chromatic aberrations within, between the beams you see a little bit of purple, which I forgot to remove to make it look even cleaner. It's more evident here, you see, purple. This should have been black, not purple. See, at 5.6, the Voigtlander will still have chromatic aberrations. You can clean those relatively easy. The problem is when they're too evident inside the colors, and that's when it turns a little crappy. Like this is not the real color. It's a little to the purple side, you know, so you need to clean those as well. I'm kind of glad I made these videos, these three videos in a row, because I can send the link to anybody who asks me about these topics in the future without having to type, you know, long answers or creating new videos and wasting everybody's time, including mine. That's all I had to say about dimensionality, micro contrast, and pop and all that stuff. Thanks a lot. Bye.